We're at the 4th annual Glaucoma Patient Summit here in Oak Brook, Illinois. Joining me is...
So my name is Dr. Barbara Wirostko, and it's such a pleasure to be here. I am an adjunct professor in ophthalmology and biomedical engineering at the University of Utah Moran Eye Center, and also very relevant to this interview, I am the co-founder and medical director for a company called My Eyes.
What is the topic of the session that you're presenting at?
So I'm going to be doing a breakout session with a patient as well as another practitioner, and it's called Glaucoma at Home.
What will you guys be discussing?
So the past few years, we've actually now have come to learn that pressure fluctuates even more so than we believed. We always knew pressure fluctuates, and we know that pressure is different when patients come in to our office over the course of the day. But now, because of a home tonometer that's available through eye care, we are now seeing that patients' pressure can actually fluctuate so much and spike even at night and in the early waking hours. So we're going to have a patient who actually is going to share that information with the group during that session.
What are some of the benefits of monitoring that pressure and identifying when it's spiking?
The reason we started My Eyes was I had several patients of my own learn that their pressures were spiking even into the 20s. And just recently I had a patient whose pressure was consistently in the high teens, low 20s in the office, but during the night she was actually spiking into the high 30s. And we've always been of the mindset, and we've always been educated, that the way to manage and treat glaucoma is by lowering your pressure. And our longitudinal studies, prospective studies, have always showed us that. So I think we have to take these pressures seriously. You know, I tend to think that if a pressure is high in the clinic and it's dangerous, then that pressure outside those clinic hours is just equally as dangerous.
What are some of the potential consequences of unmonitored spikes?
That's a great question. We don't know. We really don't know. You know, I, at this point, thank my patients for educating me, because I think we're really learning as we go. I have seen patients progressing, and when I send them home with the eye care tonometer to use in these off-clinic hours and they're spiking, I am attributing their progression to those spikes. So when I think about how to best manage those patients, it's really not so much about getting the number lower perhaps, but it's eliminating that spike and flattening that curve. So it really has started to change the way I intervene. It's also made me perhaps operate or change medical management sooner because of those spikes. But time will tell.
Can you tell us a little bit about the eye care tonometer and how it works?
So it's based on a rebound tonometry, and this is the Eye Care Home 2, which is the newer version. And you basically just center it. You will see a green circle on the inside that tells you if it's positioned correctly, and it takes a pressure literally instantaneously. No anesthetic drops with the Eye Care Home 2. What's nice is you can even measure your pressure lying flat, although that now introduces another variable, because we don't know how pressure varies, you know, even lying flat across the day. So, but it can give you a lot of information. It really is an ingenious little device that's easy to use, easy to handle, and very user-friendly.
So you mentioned information and data. Are patients able to see that themselves?
Oh, that's a great question. Yeah. So patients may be familiar with a very similar device that we use in our office, and we've used it for years. The technician will check their pressure with the eye care office unit. That will show the pressure instantaneously on the device. For these devices, the pressure reading is actually uploaded to the cloud, and then the patient or the doctor can download all the information. So not only do you get the individual number, you will get the min and the max over the span of that reading, and you'll also get a chart presentation, basically a data graph that will show you with the fluctuation and the variability.
Out of curiosity, if a patient is hoping to use one, Is this something that they have to do long term, or is it something they can apply to their lives for a month?
That's a great question as well. So the reason we started My Eyes, it was started by myself, a patient, and my technician. And it was really to get this device into the hands of patients, really to help diagnose. So a lot of times we'll use it for a week or two. The patient can rent it. All they need is a doctor's prescription. What I'm seeing now is more patients are actually thinking and saying to themselves, this is a chronic disease. And I now have a change in medication or surgical intervention. How do I know my pressure is going to stay controlled over time? So they are actually now wanting to buy it. So it really depends upon the patient. I think it really adds both to the diagnosis of those spikes and understanding likely progression, as well as being able to monitor long term. And I think this is very, you know, analogous to a glucose monitor.
We're all about advocacy and encouraging patients to take control of their glaucoma, and I definitely feel like this device is going to help them do that.
You know, it really does. And what I've heard from patients too is it provides insight, it provides information, it does enable them to take control. Again, we don't know enough about what causes the variability to understand what we can do to better manage it besides medications and surgery. But I think it really is important as we move forward. I think the other thing that's interesting too is patients can really have that discussion with their doctors. And it's so important for physicians to really understand the patient's worries, concerns, and also have that conversation. Like, look, we can try this, but it's a team approach at the end of the day.
On that note, what are some of the recommendations you would give to eye care professionals and patients when trying to strengthen their relationship and communication?
You know, we think of glaucoma as an eye disease, but it really is a manifestation of the whole person, the whole body. Studies have shown that meditation can actually reduce IOP. I've had patients that will go out and exercise, come back into the office, and if they have pigmentary glaucoma, their pressures may go up. But if they do not, their pressures actually may go down. So again, it's that listen to your patient. I think for a patient, it's important to find a physician that you feel comfortable with, that you can have that dialogue. And you can't manage glaucoma in a vacuum. You have to take into account the person, stress levels, jobs, medications, other systemic illnesses, and really think about the patient as the whole patient.
How can patients benefit from attending the Glaucoma Patient Summit?
I've been so impressed by this organization, and I am so honored to have been involved over the years. I'm really in awe of all the patients that actually have come from all over the country here to Illinois to learn and to listen and, as you said, really become an advocate for themselves and know what they can do differently to help better understand glaucoma. And it's just such a great way, I think, for us as clinicians also to see the patient's perspective. You know, sometimes we don't get to spend a lot of time with that patient in the chair, and it can be rushed, and you know, there's other patients waiting for us, and an organization that enables this type of dialogue and a day devoted to this really allows us to understand our patients better and their concerns.
Thank you so much. It was a pleasure having you.
Thank you so much.